Hi, I'm Rami Tamimi. Behind me here is a surveying total station, and this is an iPhone 12 Pro. This is the iPhone 12 Pro's LiDAR sensor. And the surveying community has been obsessed over this sensor as they wonder if its accuracy is even measurable. Lots of people are saying that this sensor can only be used for AR video games and modeling work, and that using it for measurements is very dangerous. And to an extent, that's true. This is a $1,000 phone, so the sensor on here cannot compare to a sensor that's on a $50,000 LiDAR system, let alone a system that's $200,000. The question still remains is, how accurate is the LiDAR sensor on the iPhone 12 Pro? Now, this is a total station, and as surveyors, we trust its accuracy. Out of all the equipment that we use, this is definitely one of the more accurate and precise tools because it takes relative measurements in comparison to absolute measurements like GPS units. The measurements that we take from the total station will be our baseline measurements, and the scan data that we get from the LiDAR sensor will then be compared to the data we get from the total station. Any differences we see between the two data sets will indicate that the LiDAR sensor might be less accurate by a certain degree. If you enjoy this type of content and you want to learn more about surveying and LiDAR systems, be sure to like this video. Also, subscribe to the YouTube channel and turn on the bell notification. We also just launched a surveyor's Facebook page. It's called I Am a Surveyor. Be sure to check that out. The link is in the description. Be a part of the community and share your surveying experience with surveyors around the world. All right, so this is the strip of curb that we're going to be studying. We're going to start by taking a back of curb shot over here. Then we're going to take a gutter shot right in front of it. Next, where the concrete breaks, I want to take another shot right here, and then a shot in the back to see this distance. Also, we're going to take another shot down here for the gutter. Next, we'll take another back of curb shot right before the elevation changes. And then we'll take another back of curb shot at the bottom here, as well as a gutter shot. And then that'll be all the points that we collect with the total station. These are typical measurements that we would take, back of curb, gutter, whenever we're doing a topographic survey. So the best way to test this sensor is on data collection that we would actually do in the industry. All right, so I've gone ahead and set up this total station. If you don't know how to do that, I did make a video a while back. Go ahead and watch that real quick and then come back to this video so that you can figure out the procedure, but make sure you understand how this total station is set up. Once I've set the total station up, I am going to need to take the height of this instrument because we are going to be taking vertical elevations, so it's important to know how high up our total station is. All right, and it looks like we are at 5.24. Looks like 5.24. All right, cool. All right, now I've set a back sight all the way on the other side of the street, and this is going to just set up my control network. It's a very simple control network. I've got the height of the rod, and I'm going to now take a direct measurement using the total station. Measure. Okay, cool, we've got a measurement to the backside. Now I'm gonna go over the setup parameters for our total station. All right, so I'm at the setup menu here. We are occupying point number one. Our instrument height is 5.24 feet. We're sighting point number two, that's where the backside is. And the backside height is 5.22 feet. I'm gonna go ahead and hit backside, okay? And I'm gonna check the distance in comparison to what we have on record. Boom. Our delta is zero in the horizontal and zero in the vertical, so we are right on with our coordinates. I'll hit the set angle button, which will set our angle to zero, and I'll hit check. And there we go. Our instrument is here, sighting the backside. And if we look at the total station, we can see that the horizontal angle is at 0 degrees, so we should be good to go. Now what I'm going to do is take measurements along this little strip of curb, and we're going to be measuring with the total station and then later on scanning it with our iPhone's LiDAR sensor. All right, let's get started.
All right, I'm going to start by sighting the first point. Okay, good. Uh-huh. Good. Three more shots. All right. Good. All right. One more.
All right. Looking good. Okay, great. We're done collecting data. Now, the only thing I'm gonna do is just rotate the total station and check zero to make sure that nothing happened, no disalignments or any orientation issues happened. All right, and let's take a look. and our horizontal angle is at 1 second. So we are all good. All right, now I've got the iPhone 12 Pro Max, and right here is the LiDAR sensor. Now we're going to be testing this LiDAR sensor's accuracy in comparison to the total station measurements that we just took. The goal here is to use the results of the LiDAR sensor and compare them to the baseline measurements of the total station. All right, so I've got the LiDAR sensor on and we're gonna go ahead and scan this little bit of curve and start recording data. There we go. Go nice and slow here. Okay, I'm gonna come over on this side and continue to scan. And I think that should be good. It's gonna go ahead and generate our tin. Get in here and look at that. Very nice. Come over on this side. Can look at the vertices here and yeah, you can see it's a pretty tight tin. Look over here, yeah. I'm gonna go ahead and share this. What kind of export do I want here? I'm gonna select point cloud. We're gonna select LAS. Okay, I've set myself a LiDAR. And there you go, now we've got the scan and we're gonna head back into the office and compare this data to what we got with the total station.
Hello and welcome to the office. All right, so I've gone ahead and loaded up AutoCAD Civil 3D and imported the LAS file into Recap, which is Autodesk's version of, you know, point cloud processing. And then I brought in the point cloud from Recap and this is the final result. As you can see, we have the curb, not too bad, actually. It looks pretty good. So it's gonna be a little tricky to maneuver through this, but we're gonna do our best to pick out all the points that we need for this project. So as I zoom into this point cloud, and I'm actually gonna increase the size of the points briefly here. So where you see the color change here between the asphalt and the curb is not necessarily where the elevation changes. So how do we find the exact change of the elevation? Well, when we click on the point cloud, we come up here where it says scan colors. I'm gonna drop down this menu and go down to elevation. And you can see now the point cloud has changed and now I'm gonna decrease the size of the points so it's a little easier to see the features. Okay, so you can see now majority of this point cloud is turned green and that's because it's taking all the values of the point cloud. We're really only concerned with the curb. And so what I'm gonna do is come over to the color mapping. Okay, and what we're going to do now is we're going to deselect the apply to extents of point cloud option. This is now utilizing every point on the point cloud. And again, we only need the points that are around the curb. So we're going to deselect it. And now it's gonna ask us a few questions. It's gonna ask us what we want our minimum elevation to be. During the first control point, I assumed an elevation of 100. So I'm just gonna say the minimum elevation is 100. And a maximum elevation. Now these curbs, they're usually within half a foot to a foot in height. So I'm gonna just say the maximum should be 101 feet. And then the interval height, it's giving me a default of 1/10. But I want to be a little more precise than that. I would like 5/100ths of a foot. So I'm just gonna type in 0.05. Okay. All right, cool. Now it's saying we're gonna have 20 different colors around our spectrum. Okay, all this looks good to me. So I'm gonna go ahead and hit okay. And as you can see, the points that are north of an elevation of 101 remain at their RGB values, and elevations of points that are below 100 also retain their RGB color values. But everything in the middle between 100 and 101, we now have a color for it. Okay, so what I'm gonna start by doing now is just increasing the size of these points so that it's easier to see. It's really hard to do this kind of work when the points are so tiny. So we've increased the size of the points. Okay, all right, I'm gonna go ahead and start with the curb. All right, this looks like a decent angle. Looks like going up, this is roughly the point. So I'm gonna use the 3D poly command, which is going to create a 3D polyline. And I have the 3D OSnap command on, which is that little blue circle with an X on it. It's kind of hard to see. I'm trying to bring it here into the white points. Yeah, you see it there. So I'm gonna use that to help me select my point, and I think I'm going to pick this point right here. Okay, we're gonna come over to this side of the curb, and as you remember, the curb breaks, so we want to select the point where it breaks. And I can see the break is right here, so I want to select right where the color changes, right there, perfect. Then we're gonna come down before the color changes again to the light blue. So right there. Perfect. Then we can see here's the curve before it depreciates down. Okay, right there. And now I want to come down to where the wall is. I want to get that back corner. I think it's going to be the lowest point, which is like this yellow right here. And select it and end the line. Great. And if I go ahead and just freeze the point cloud, you can see I've now traced the curb of the point cloud. And now let's go ahead and do the gutter. So I'm gonna thaw out the point cloud again, and we're gonna select points. All right, I'm gonna go ahead and change my layer to LiDAR gutter, and I'm going to orient myself here. This might be a good spot right here. Again, you can see when the elevation decides to start going up, it's like right at the start of the orange. So that'll be when I start to click. So 3D poly, selecting right here. And I'm gonna come over, rotate a little bit. So we can see where that break is. It's happening right here. So I wanna try to get a shot of the gutter in this location right here. Okay, and I wanna select it right here. And one more point. Okay, cool. Now we've got both the curb and the gutter in. I am gonna just go ahead and freeze our point cloud. If we take a look here, you can see the profile. Now that looks like a curb and gutter. Look at that. All right, so what I'm going to do now is I'm gonna open up the point creation toolbar, and I'm gonna create some points along these polylines. Just go to point creation tool, miscellaneous manual. We'll come here, we'll select this one. Okay, now I'm going to change this layer to LiDAR gutter. Okay, point creation, we're gonna come back over here, and we're going to select these points here and right here. If I come into points, I select edit points. Now I've got a group of points here with northings, eastings, and elevations. Now I'm just gonna right click, select export. It's gonna ask me where I wanna export these points to. And now I've selected the destination of where I wanna export. And I'm just going to call this LiDAR points. And I wanna save it as a CSV. And okay. And there we go. Now we've saved the points. Let's go ahead and open up that CSV and then open up our points from our total station and begin comparing the coordinates. Here we have the coordinates of the total station. And here we have the coordinates of the iPhone's LiDAR system. Now I know a lot of people are thinking, Rami, how in the world did you get this point cloud to be on the same local system as your total station? And to that, I have to come clean and tell you the exact procedure that I used when I imported the point cloud. I referenced two points from the total station. These two points allowed me to align my point cloud to the local system that we have. It was the only way I was able to tie these two data sets together. So that means two of these points are gonna have zero difference. Points 102 and 107 are going to be exactly the same. Okay, I just want everyone to be very clear about that. The differences from those two points have nothing to do with the accuracy because I did an alignment. What we are going to look at are all the other points, because this will show the relative distance between the points and whether or not the LiDAR sensor on the iPhone 12 Pro can genuinely measure differences in distance and in elevation. So what we're going to do is create a simple equation of equals, and I'm gonna select the northing of point 101 and subtract it from the northing of 101 on the LiDAR data set. Okay, I'm going to click on this and copy the formula all the way down and copy it over. And I'm going to highlight these cells and block them because just like I explained, these points were used for alignment. If you have more questions, please leave me a comment. I will do my best to answer what I did in my procedure. Okay, now let's look at some of these differences. I'm literally blown away. Point number 101 has literally a difference in northing of 0.04, 0.08 in the easting, and 0.05 in elevation. That's crazy. That is really, really close. Point number 103 has a difference of about 0.3 in the northing, 0.09 in the easting, and man, the elevation is right on 0.03. Again, so close. I did not expect that. Point number 104, northing, 0.025, easting, looks about 0.1 difference. Again, elevation, 100th. I'm more blown away about the elevation differences, because it almost seems like elevation is so hard to achieve, but here we are coming in at about 1/100 of a foot. 105, we've got 1/1500ths. Again, that's following the trend here. The easting is about 5/100ths, and elevation this time is about 1/1400ths. Still super tight, super good. I really like that. Point number 106, we've got about 2/10ths in the northing, 6/10ths in the easting. Now this is the biggest difference that we have. Again, elevation 0.02. And the last point, we've got a difference in northing 7/100ths, easting 6/100ths, and elevation is 9/100ths. So again, I'm really blown away by how within a tenth, I would say comfortably a tenth, definitely some spots like right here where it was, you know, 2/10ths, 6/10ths, but elevation wise we were good. And this could really be just me picking the wrong spot. You know, you saw how difficult it was. It wasn't the easiest task in the world. There's better software out there. Unfortunately, the iPhone's LiDAR doesn't give you an intensity output as well, which would be amazing to have. So all I had to rely on was the elevation changes. Nonetheless, for the amount of work that I did, I was able to extract some relatively accurate data. And I think now, as us surveyors continue to discuss the accuracy of this LiDAR sensor, I've done an actual test, and I have to say it was beyond my expectations. I did not see this coming. I was really expecting 0.5 to 1 foot of difference, but for it to be about, you know, 1/10th in difference, you know, I would say that's pretty astonishing and very impressive. I hope you guys like my video today. If you've got questions or suggestions, I highly encourage you to leave a comment down below. I would love to interact with you. I want to see what you guys think. You know, was this scientific enough? Should we do more testing? Tell me what your thoughts are. What should we do to further this? If you like this kind of content and you want to see more, be sure to like this video. Also, subscribe to my YouTube channel and turn on the bell notification so you don't miss out on any of my latest content. Also, if you'd like to take this conversation over to Facebook, we've got a private Facebook page. Go ahead and click on the link in the description and be a part of our community and interact with surveyors all around the world. Thanks guys for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.